Radiant team ban. Dire team ban. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Radiant team pick.
Hello everybody and welcome to some more We Play Season 3. Once again, we've got Americas on our hands and we've got Power of Friendship versus Digital Chaos. I'm Llama Down Under. I'm going to be joined by the Wonder Cow. How you going?
I'm doing very well after that little break between Europe and now. Got refreshed and ready to go here with DC versus Power of Friendship.
Now, I am not super sure what to expect. DC has been blazing their way through this tournament. They are undefeated. They have been doing some 15-minute stomps as of late. And Power of Friendship, they're playing with Slicks all of a sudden.
10 seconds remaining.
Yeah, not only that, but obviously DC now playing with Resolution as well. So a couple of relatively new pickups here for each of these teams. Also, interestingly, we did just have a patch, or a sub-patch rather, that nerfed both Lone Druid and Earth Spirit, the bans for Power of Friendship. So we won't see those heroes in play today.
Yeah, I'm not super... The Earth Spirit nerf, I don't think it's as big. A lot of people are claiming it's a huge deal. I really don't.
It's like a pretty big deal to me.
I think the power of the hero is in the early game, where he can rotate and kill everybody, anywhere in the game. You know, you got at level 1 at 80% movement slow for 2 seconds.
Yeah.
The Axe is, yeah, it's great, but also only something that's picked up in 35% of pro matches. So... how much that is enough, we'll see. Either way, we got a draft on our hands, and Tidehunter!
5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, the Tide with Venge, that's not necessarily a combination that you look at and say, look at the synergy, but they're both very strong heroes. Tidehunter's going to give them some AoE control. You do have the negative armor to go on top of that, which means Power Friendship could be looking to take some pretty effective team fights.
I do... like the Tidehunter from the standpoint, as you mentioned, there's some stuff you can do. Big AoE Ravage helps you out with the Faceless Void. But again, DC have the combo. Faceless Void, Invoker, they've been picking this up a bunch. Allows Resolution to go full Exort, Sunstrike things. I'm not sure of the way you stop this.
That's not a player that you want to give the Invoker to. But that said, we've seen... as you already mentioned, the overwhelming potency of an Earth Spirit and Lone Druid as well. The Savage Roar nerf on Lone Druid obviously has not been played out yet in professional Dota, but I would be very surprised if it made that big of a difference in the laning phase, to be honest. Which is really where, when you're going up against Digital Chaos and they're pulling out 9-minute Midases in the offlane and Radiance is faster than your opponent's carry, as we saw yesterday or 2 days ago. Yeah, it's not a hero you want to give up either.
A lot of these bans from Power of Friendship seem really targeted. Obviously, all of these players know each other pretty well. I'm pretty sure I'm remembering it correctly. Way 2 and Aoi, and even Sneaking and Aoi have played on the same team, and I'm sure they've all played in houses together. So they know each other well, but... if you ban all of, you know, you've got 2 Aoi bans there, we got maybe a Bulba or arguably an Aoi ban there in the Enchantress, and then another Bulba ban. Especially when I think the Faceless Void is going off, I'm a little surprised.
Well, I think for Power of Friendship, they're coming in at a, I think it's reasonable to say, substantial ranking disadvantage between them and Digital Chaos. And... the best way for them to try to move forward is make sure that Digital Chaos are not getting their best heroes. It might not necessarily be about trying to keep Digital Chaos from countering. It might not necessarily be about trying to keep Digital Chaos from getting synergized heroes, but really just about trying to keep them from being well within their comfort zone.
And it is something to be said. We see this time and time again. Captains always say it. They would rather their players be comfortable on heroes than picking heroes that are just known to be strong. So also, just as a heads up, this is Power of Friendship's first game in this tournament. It is all best of ones, so anything can happen. I don't think Power of Friendship is the master of this strat, but we've seen other teams, like Complexity is famous for pulling out Roshan strats when they're in best of ones and so on, just because it's so, you can't counter it in the next game. And Power of Friendship might have something up their sleeve here that works in a best of one when your opponent's not expecting it.
Yeah, or even you just get off to a good early game start, you happen to get both runes and a fast first blood, somebody makes a misstep and it spirals out of control, right? Anything can happen in a single game. There's no sense of impossibility in a single game. That really starts to come out when you play 2, 5, 7 game series.
Now, Digital Chaos still have the Oracle in the pool. I wonder if 1437 might pick that up, something we've seen him do well on. They go with the Witch Doctor, though. So, again, another hero. If 1437, I think it was him, does what he did the other day where he got the Midas on the Witch Doctor and then had the, like, 25-minute ags or earlier, yeah, it's going to be a good time.
Right, but though, arguably, if your Witch Doctor is getting an Ags that early, chances are you're so far ahead that Ags is just a cherry on the ice cream, right? But the Faceless Void Witch Doctor synergy is blatant and obvious. Also gives him a bit more push with the healing aura, the Voodoo Restoration.
Radiant team pick.
So, Power of Friendship going to pick out the Outworld Devourer. The stack on top of the Tidehunter for the big AoE, you've got a nice weave into Sandy's Eclipse with the Ravage. That could be very potent.
Yeah, you can certainly set up for your spells, but again, we've got kind of two competing strategies here, right? Obviously, Ravage is magical, the Arcane Orb is pure, the Sanity's Eclipse is magical, and then we have Minus Armor coming out from Venge and Dazzle. I'll be interested to see what Power of Friendship decide to pick, who can really bring this together, because right now it's a bit of a hodgepodge of different strategies. Although, as you mentioned, if you hit one good team fight, right, you might just wipe them all.
And the other aspect there is that there is the Vengeance Orb from the Vengeful, so you do have the negative armor from the Weave on top of the Ravage, but that buys time for right clicks. And with the Vengeance Aura sitting there giving everybody a little more physical damage, you have some level of synergy there.
Definitely a nice lineup, unlike some we've seen earlier, where you will be forcing some of those cores into BKBs potentially, which is always something a core doesn't want since you have a nice mix of magical and physical. Now for DC, they have options for this lineup. Aren't particular, I mean, Bulba has shown a wide hero pool, so I think DC have lots of options.
They haven't necessarily married themselves to a strategy yet, right? They could try to do a push strategy on the back of the Invoker Witch Doctor and grab something else that's going to push. Try to do AoE team fight strategy with the Faceless Void and the Witch Doctor. They could try to do a 4-protect-1 with the Faceless Void and the Invoker being your main mid-game cores. And this next pick should give us an idea of where they want to go once they break into the game, because right now they do have a lot of options available.
Yeah, and it's even something. Okay.
Looks like AoE and push it is.
Certainly a solid strategy. We've seen this before from teams. DC's been running, I wouldn't necessarily call them push strats. They've also been just overwhelming their opponents, but in there have been a few push strats. So I wouldn't be surprised to see comfort there. And with a Sven, you can actually pair quite a lot. So they've got a really flexible loss slot open. They can go to one of their common heroes, the Oracle, the Disruptor. Oh!
Radiant.
Interesting.
The lack of Ancient Apparition, you're saying, is interesting?
The AA ban out. I wasn't expecting that from Power of Friendship. I was expecting it as something maybe DC would go for, since, as you said, they potentially have the push. Sure, the AA really hurts the Dazzle, but that's the only hero there.
I think they were going for that Morphling. I was about to say, I think they're going to pick up a Morphling here, but Digital Chaos saw it and got in front of it. I mean, 1437 is an amazingly experienced player and captain and draft analyst. So that AA may have given away the gambit of what Power of Friendship wanted, because Morphling is a hero that we've seen rising in popularity, and he is a hero that you cannot really play into a good AA. You'll just Reserve crumble.
Time. And yeah, that all makes a lot of sense. So we'll see whether Power of Friendship have another thing up their sleeve. I mean, just for simple things that nicely synergize with the Minus Element, Jug is always a solid carry. Of course, he can get caught out, but he has this kind of a spin away, maybe to get out of some of the Invoker spells. Probably would need a BKB this game, but you've got some escapes, and the Omni Slash synergizes well with the Minus Element coming out.
Yep. Jug would be a pretty decent pick here. I think Medusa actually would be a pretty decent pick here. Uh-huh. There's a lot of heroes that really have no... Okay, the Ursa actually a pretty decent pick here too into the Faceless Void. Now that you don't have Backtrack anymore, Ursa much more potent into a Faceless Void. Sven needs to be up close and personal. Witch Doctor does not have a particularly high health pool. And Ursa does do fairly well into strategies that require... Sudden Burst. So if you're looking at God Strength into Stormhammer with the potential of a Death Ward, the Enrage can do a lot of work into mitigating some of that damage.
Power of Friendship does still have, I think, a little difficult of a draft to execute, because even though their team fight is overwhelming, if they blow the Ravage and don't get a bunch of kills, or even if they do, that's a big window for Digital Chaos to take advantage of.
Digital Chaos are going to double down on their trying to get early game momentum with the Bounty Hunter, get some of those track kills up, and probably use it to harass the mid lane OD substantially. That is a hero who needs levels, which means if you can force your either force him back out of the lane or force his supports to rotate to help him and slow him down, he very often will become just antiquated and useless. Right, so for OD to get off to a bad start is often it's the death throes of the entire game.
Yeah, you can put them in a really bad spot. So going into it, we have the Scouting Sunstrike, of course. Resolution's going to be able to go. Okay, never mind. That was funky stuff. What did Slix just re-itemized? There we go. I just saw him, some money go into him, and I was super confused. I'm really interested to see how Snake King does, because I think while there's certainly ways to kill people here, it's really hard to play an Ursa around a Chronosphere, around a Sven, who will hit you just as hard.
Yeah, I think the goal here is get the initiation with a magic missile, and then have Snake King come in and do the rest before there's any opportunity to re-engage. And then you're fighting 5-on-4. And if they engage into you, you have the Ravage, right? Maybe he'll go in and try to... Ooh, wow, owie, getting pretty far forward there. There are two sentries sitting waiting to scout for potentially owie here. This could be danger.
Is going to pop around the tree. He's seen them. And oh, Mario... Okay.
Yeah, they saw him.
We'll see if they actually find him. I don't know whether he'll do the top rune play. I think Aoi probably aware. He's seen them, so he's seen that they have detection. Wow, they have a lot of sentries, actually. Yeah. They have 4 sentries across the team. Slix is not planning on losing these ward wars in mid lane. And Aoi drops a ward. Full vision of their team, and yeah, we're going to have a normal rune split.
Okay, yeah, this is pretty good. Oh, and Aoi's getting ready for the bottle snipe already.
And we saw this in, I think it was DC versus Shazam. Aoi managed to get that. We do see
it's
Dazzle
already coming out,
oh,
too.
Oh, no. I thought Way 2 was going back for it.
Oh,
you
boy.
Can't even leave it up there. Last time they left it up there, Aoi just walked in and took the tower hits.
Aoi doesn't know it's up there yet because it hasn't come down off the high ground.
And the courier's going back.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, so they'll probably, I hope... Oh, no. Okay, it's just moving. Either way, let's focus somewhere else. We'll hear if the courier dies. Bulba on top is taking a lot of damage. You already talked about this, the Fury Swipes. Even with Backtrack, it puts a lot into you.
Right, or rather, without the Backtrack to dodge some of the
time
walk.
With the time walk, yeah. New name.
New name, same general idea. Get rid of the damage as quickly as we can. Now he's going to rotate down onto MJW. This shouldn't be a kill, but
no,
will be annoying. Now the courier is going to get called. They know Aoi's not there. That was really smart by Power of Friendship.
It's just little things. A lot of folks, you know, it's just little mistakes that can win, or little good plays that can help you out in winning a game. It seems small. A lot of people are like, oh, Bounty Hunter, you must have a lot of experience against it. teams still forget, and that's why we see so many Couriers die.
Right, yeah, it's really just the amount of awareness that it takes to know, oh, we saw Aoi running this way in our jungle. He's probably going to snipe our courier. He might be waiting there already and not waiting for the bottle to come out. We should wait until we see him somewhere on the map. That level of awareness that it takes is professional level awareness.
Now, we're going to see a really odd ward, actually. They're giving it a go onto Tide again. I don't think they're going to catch him. MJW has hit level 2, but so has Bulba, who is very sneaky in here. And this ward is going to spot him out, but it's a little high in the lane. It's not going to see any TP rotations. So if Bulba receives help, they're not going to know on Power of Friendship.
At least they will see somebody just rolling on up into the lane from the tower, right? You got to get from the tower to the lane time. And that seems to be the case. They just want to absolutely be sure that they are secure in this lane, and because they do have the poles, they shouldn't lose equilibrium too substantially.
And in the mid lane, Aoi probably gonna take a turn in here, because Resolution actually, for once in this series, not having the time of his life.
Yeah, he had trouble yesterday,
in the Zeus
too.
Game.
Yeah, the Zeus game. He had a lot of trouble, but there was just such great play from everybody else on DC that they bought him the time to come back, and it was a really impressive bout of teamwork.
And currently, his Invoker on DC is undefeated.
Yeah, that is true. I mean, his Invoker is just world-class, right? The Courier is coming out. It's not yet flying. It'll probably be upgraded to flying and then flown out here at a bottle. Yeah, with the bottle for OD.
But in the meantime, Slick's having a blast in mid. He's a little ahead. It's not super dominant. Aoi is gonna realize he's seen because the creeps are attacking him, as is Slicks, who Astral imprisons him. I don't think there's enough damage for a kill, but he suddenly tells Aoi to get out of town.
Yeah, if that sentry ward happened to be a bit harder before, there probably would have been
the Sunstrike and MGW will be your first blood in the bottom lane.
Nice awareness. Throwing the Sunstrike out there.
Yeah, I mean,
While there's a fight going on in his lane, you know.
We see this time and time again from Resolution. He throws out really good Sunstrikes. They don't always hit, but he's always on point with where he knows they need to be. So even though he maybe is having some trouble in his lane, or I shouldn't say trouble, you know, he's not dominating his lane,
yeah,
but
he's
still able to help.
Basically even, right? Which is, this is not the easiest matchup in the world for an Invoker with your intelligence stolen. You could find yourself with a bit of trouble. Also, Invoker is not a hero who contests rune very effectively. He doesn't want to leave lane because he wants to get levels, and he doesn't typically hurt for mana, so he doesn't get a bottle. And heroes that don't contest rune tend to do worse into OD, because it means OD gets uncontested runes, which really benefit him.
Yeah, OD has the additional help of the Tidehunter had been rotating a little bit. Can't anymore, since he's only level 3, but... Oh, we're gonna see Witch Doctor come in as well. There's actually some really nice coconuts set up here because of that creep being so close to Slicks. And the wraparound, here it comes, the coconuts come out, and there's the bounce. Slicks gonna walk right into the Sunstrike, has the Astral Imprisonment for himself, but even though just the Maledict when he comes out might be enough, and suddenly these auto attacks from Resolution. There he goes.
Really great. The fact that Aoi happened to be there, or didn't happen to be there, Aoi rotated in time to get himself a chunk of that kill as well, is going to help. Bounty Hunters sometimes run into this trouble where they are rotating too much and they don't get enough in the early game, and the track kills don't come out early in the team, and momentum starts to sputter out around that 11-minute mark. So sometimes you see that out of Bounty Hunters, and as long as he's getting a chunk of a lot of these kills, it probably won't happen to him.
I think Aoi making some good work happen. The other things to note is the carries are about tied across the team, and of course now Resolution has a slight lead. It does feel like if this game just continues at the pace, especially since Aoi, you know, he hasn't been in lane and is still able to make this impact, DC is pulling just a little bit ahead.
Yeah, they are going to continue to pull a bit ahead. OD should do fine in his lane, but he's not a hero that we usually see going out and getting a lot of early kills. Dazzle is not necessarily a kill hero, he's more of a sustain hero, right? The Vengeful Spirit does have some kill potential, but he's the one sitting here doing stacks and pulls for his lane. So there's just not a lot of rotation and kill potential coming out of Power Friendship the way they've decided to lane this, and because of that, they're probably hoping to get into the mid-game transition more smoothly rather than trying to take control of this stage of the game.
It's going to be really difficult for them because DC, ever on point, this ward and this ward, not only a blocking ward, but if the Ursa went for an early Roche, you know, in the smoke, that's commonly where you smoke for it. So Ursa not going to have an easier time sneaking that Roche on.
Of course, he wouldn't do it now because that's blocked and they know that there's vision there. But even so, it has forced MJW completely out of that offlane as well, meaning Sven and Witch Doctor have completely free lane. 1437 is going to get an early level 6 because Sven's able to go into the jungle with his Mask of Madness and the Witch Doctor can solo lane uncontested.
And Bounty being a jerk, stealing some experience from MJW. Not sure if MJW knows, but of course, it's going to slow his progression as well. And yeah, because
it's working perfectly, right? Forced him into the jungle, you get extra experience across the map, and the bounty hunter can now safely contest experience in the jungle.
Yeah, and also because of that, they have not, when they don't know where Aoi is, they were just sticking the dazzle behind the OD. A little bit worried. Do they have dust or anything?
No,
they're just gonna harass. Go. Okay, they dropped the Sanity's Eclipse.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's an only kill. Oh. It's good enough.
They do have dust as well on the Dazzle.
They go for it. In this case, it's something a lot of the times we'll see people consider holding those big ults. In this case,
yeah.
I don't think with the way the tide's going that he was going to be getting ready for a big Ravage Sanity's Eclipse anytime soon. So, getting Slicks and a little bit of extra farm seems like the decision.
Yeah, the decision to hold on to that or not hold on to that probably comes down to their expectations of how aggressive DC will be and not the other way around. Because as I said, it doesn't look like Power Friendship are really gearing up to be that aggressive through this early game. Though they will contest this rune and they might get a kill for it.
I'm a little surprised they choose not to be aggressive. I feel like, oh, okay, Yawar in a little bit of trouble. Does have the Storm Hammer up in a few seconds, but just going to wander away. They're running.
There's just an Astral Imprisonment into a Stormhammer, and, you know, the de-escalation from there.
When you're running a lineup with Ursa, the way we normally see this played is Ursa just runs and eats your face. So I'm a little surprised.
He does need a couple of levels, right? He can't really close the gap, usually. Wow.
Okay, and there's going to be a Death Ward and the Sunstrike. It's Ursa. Oh, Snaking, using that ult to keep himself alive. They're actually going to get the return kill on Bulba. The Maledict should finish off this Ursa, but amazing that they got something. And actually, maybe it won't. Way Too has a shallow grave for Snaking, and he's going to be just fine.
Yeah, that's painful. Definitely, and... Dude, that's exactly what you were just talking about, that Ursa able to turn it around. And remember, I was Dyer's talking in the draft that Enrage's ability to survive that burst damage that's going to come out of that sort of situation.
Yeah. And again, just on point courier movements. The courier was flying the normal way back home, and then they tilt it upwards and make sure Aoi isn't able to snipe it.
Aoi spends a lot of time chasing this courier, and the games where he gets the courier, definitely well worth the time chasing it. But the games where he doesn't get the courier ends up being... painful. It ends up sending him back notably. He's not even level 4 yet at almost 10 minutes into the game.
An ideal timing is level 6 on a bounty hunter, 12 minutes in. That's good. If you can get it earlier, that's fantastic. But they're going to sneak this Rosh on. The creep will find out way too late. Ursa's got it. And
yep.
There they go.
We're starting to see the laning phase should collapse here pretty soon for Power of Friendship. This is precisely what they wanted. A smooth transition into the mid game out of the laning phase. Their OD almost sitting on this item, I assume, here, moving out, and Dazzle does have the boots up. So they've got everything they need in order to start trying to get some ganks out for this Ursa, and maybe push a tower with that Aegis as well.
Now, we've seen that type of thing before, where folks try to use the threat of ultimates. OG used to do this a lot with the Brewmaster. They use the threat of the Brewmaster ult to get successful pushes. You can do this a similar thing with the Tide. You think that's how Power Friendship will go? Or are you expecting more of a single pickoff gank attempts?
I think anytime they can get a pickoff beforehand, they'll try to get the pickoff beforehand. But they don't know. Oh, never mind. Sneaking's going to come in here. I don't think that they quite have the gap closed
yet. They don't
yet.
Have the blink yet. That's actually, I was going to ask, because that's to me, I was really surprised. Obviously, Lifesteal, great on Ursa with the changes to Fury Swipes. He can make full use of this. Doesn't need to go only, you know, Vlad's isn't his only item that he can go. But blink seems so powerful. If you can get on top of someone, you get that Earthshock off, you overpower, they die.
Yeah. It really, they have the Venge to do the initiating, I think, and they also have the Astral Imprisonment to open it up, and that's presumably what he's counting on. Though it does seem like he is going to farm up his Blink before they actually try to engage with this. Dire structures. Maybe not. I mean, he's thinking about rotating up and trying to get a return kill on this void. Probably just end up staying in the jungle, yeah.
Void is such a hard target. Even though we've seen them manage to pick off Bulba, that was when Bulba had already expended his time warp, and that seems to be about the way you catch someone like a Void, like a Quoth. And speaking of catches, there is going to be 14370C snaking and just walks all the way away, and in mid, Slix throws out the Astral Imprisonment, but here comes Resolution, Cold Snap at the ready. That should be it. So much disengage on both sides.
Yeah. DC probably need to wait until they get level 6 on Bounty Hunter. Right, he's about to hit that 12 minute mark. He's still only level 4, as you'd mentioned, 12 about where you'd want your bounty hunter to get 6. So they're probably going to need to just give him a lane for a little while, just soak.
They're trying to let him safely get some farm in mid. It shouldn't take too long with that lane pushing in. Although now with a haster and up on Slix, you have to be careful. I don't know. Okay, he should just casually use the Sanity's Eclipse. You know,
as he did earlier.
So, but surprisingly, compared to our earlier games, which had too much action to talk at some parts in this morning, this game, rather slow and steady. DC is pulling ahead when it comes to net worth, about 2,000 gold ahead, 3,000 experience, and that is something that one team fight can turn around, but they are currently farming a little bit better.
They are farming a little bit better, but Power Friendship are doing an excellent job maintaining control of the throttle of this game. This is about the pace that they expected, it's about the pace they wanted. Their heroes don't inherently farm as fast as their opponent's heroes, right? So it's not that weird for them to be falling slightly behind here. Their goal, I assume, I would speculate, would be to get a good team fight to make that up and then push the towers with their Ursa. Right.
I am still really worried. Okay, we have a Ravage. Okay, well, goodbye, Bulba. They solo ravage him, but they get the kill, and again, that is a big kill. They have 30 seconds to try and get a push done, knowing that they don't have to worry about Chronosphere.
That ravage interrupted what I believe was a Chronosphere attempt as well, a three-man Chrono. So MJW with the reaction time.
Radiant and Ravage does have a bit of a cost, but well, it's technically instant if you blink right on top of the person. Other than that, it has a cost point.
Which happened to be the case. I mean, Void blinked right on top of him, right? That was... They were touching faces when that went down.
I did want to say, though, obviously the Ravage is down. DC have an opportunity to either... Okay, it looks like we may just see Aoi go down again. There is the dust. There are going to be the auto attacks. And Bulba is here with the ult. Way 2 is going to be the target. Sunstrike has picked him off. And Slick still being hit by that Sanity. The Eclipse is thrown up, and he's going to fall. There is backup incoming, but the Coconuts managed to hit Snaking. And they have lost already a number of them. Snaking pushed backwards by that Deafening Blast. And Mario is just dead from the burn of the Meteor. All of a sudden...
Yeah, that is the opposite of what the Power of Friendship wanted in that engagement. Their Blink Dagger is up on the Ursa. He might actually, as soon as this ult is done on Sven, he might engage and try to just
He does have Enrage, but this is... Oh, goodness, he is... Oh, just playing around them, Snaking. He is indeed risking it all. Bulba could potentially come in. I think other than a time dilation, not too much. And there we go.
It just expires as well, so he no longer has that bonus. Presumably what he was thinking there is if they kill me, I've got Aegis, I can blink away. If they don't kill me, at least I bought a couple more seconds on the tower. But it was a very high-risk play, certainly, but even just showing himself.
This entire team fight engagement was what I was worried about with Power Friendship's lineup. The Tide had no Ravage. Yeah. DC took advantage of that, knew that they could jump in. Nothing would stop the Chronosphere. Nothing would stop Resolution from getting off his spell kit. And they're also so long on Power Friendship.
Yeah, hindsight is 20/20, but honestly, I'm not sure that the Void would have been able to get a kill if he did that three-man Chrono earlier. But because he died, he still had it up. And the combination between that Chrono and the Witch Doctor's Death Ward turned out to be far more fatal than the lone jungle Void encounter that they otherwise would have.
You are finishing off the stack here, so getting close to whatever he wants next. Could go for a BKB, could just finish off the Sand and Yasha, the style that Havost likes a lot.
Counter ward coming out here from Mario as well. I'm not sure if you caught that, but...
Another one also from 1437 in mid. They are ward wars.
But 1437 did also ping out that counter where it happened, so presumably, they are thinking about whether or not they should now go re-counter ward in case there is an observer up there from the other team at this point.
The map is dark for both teams. Really, they have
good control.
Really on point with this. Aoi does have one ward on him, but other than that, both sides out of wards for another, you know, 10 seconds or so, and then they're only going to have one up. That's a really big deal. Yuwar taking a lot of damage. There is no escape from snaking. He throws out the Stormhammer, but the damage is already done. They even swap him back. Finish him off. So, nice man.
And the blink is up for snaking. He can move into this mid lane if 1437 doesn't extricate himself right now.
Yeah, he's gonna hoof it, and once again, Sanity's Eclipse is up, Tidehunter has the ult up, Ravage is ready. Things get scary here for DC. They have to make sure that these ults don't hit everyone.
Yeah, they also need to start getting some track kills, because I don't think they've gotten any yet, but Bounty Hunter does have track now.
In the meantime, snaking, waiting in the sidelines. 1437 places a ward, aware that there might have been vision. He blinks, but guesses wrong, and Aoi, just standing on the sidelines, probably gonna throw out a track here. The snaking can't be so sneaky. But other than that, DC's positioning seems great for this.
Yeah, they are going to have to choose whether or not they want to engage to save this tower or not. The void nowhere nearby, neither is resolution. They're going to chip at this tier 2, but they probably can't take it.
Still getting damage on a tier 2 when your opponents are taking a tier 1 of less value, since that top lane more important, I think, than the mid lane for DC. It's...
Yeah, I don't know if 300 damage is really ends up being worth that much, but if you get substantial damage, I definitely...
It's also hard to say, because losing the mid tower is closer to Rosh, right?
Right, that is the primary teleport location. If you can keep that mid tier 1 up, it doesn't matter if you're losing the side lane, at least on Radiant side.
Either way, we'll be seeing that happen, and it means that DC, they're about 4,000 net worth ahead, 5,000 experience. Not too much to say about that. Looks like a smoke going to be coming out of them.
They're going to potentially run into the entire squad of Power Friendship if they run into anybody. Power Friendship very clustered right now.
Yeah, OD is looking like a juicy target, but of course that is a bait, and they are not going to find anyone. Yuwar actually breaks it to steal their Ancients. He has popped his ult as well.
Smart. They don't plan on engaging here. They're going to back right out. So might as well take the Ancients. They might even think about Rosh. Know that they can even take it, though.
It was a very fast respawn time, so the folks on Power Friendship may not even check it. Yuwar does have a little bit of that God Strength left, but it's gone now. They have a lot of regen here, so they should be fine. We're also sun-striking Rosh, and it's too fast. Our Friendship aren't going to get their smoke off in time. They actually have a smoke at the ready to blow, because I think that they're worried about this Roshan, but it's going to be way too late, and the smoke has been thrown, but it's already done.
Yeah, Power Friendship needed to be faster there. That Rosh actually took a while. It took like 15 seconds almost, right? Even with the God Strength, they had time to kind of get over, but they didn't have a ward up for one thing. This is a brand new fresh ward. So they didn't have a ward up to see Sven go in there, and that was the saving grace for that Rosh.
Also, Aoi just broke their smoke, and unfortunately, it looks like nobody had dust
on the Dazzle.
He just didn't blow it, I guess.
But there's also Ben just sitting on top of the sentry ward.
Well, they put that after.
Oh, did they? Okay. Well, he has one in his inventory, too. So.
Oh. So he placed this one, I think, hoping maybe Aoi would come by, but he'd seen it all.
Well, they should be able to force a tower here. I don't think there's going to be rotation to defend. Resolution might try to chip away here. And maybe a tier 2 top trade attempt, but by the time they can get to that tier 2, this tier 1 will be down.
It feels like there's almost no point for DC to fight them head on unless they know the ults are down, because they can trade effectively. Yes, this tier 1 will go, but if DC gets a tier 2, that's obviously the better trade. Sven could pop the God Strength here to get it faster.
Yeah, the one maybe argument against that is that the Bounty Hunter likes trades hero for hero, because you get more out of track kill than your opponents get out of basically any kill. Right?
We're gonna have the meatball. MJW mechs up and walks on out of it. The rest of the team is at the ready for DC. Okay, Bulba, he's looking for it. He's looking for that big old ult. Snaking gonna take the stun. Bulba still doesn't go for it. I think waiting for more.
Yeah, he doesn't want to do it on just the Ursa. Blink now off on the Sven, though.
I mean, I think their patience paid off. As you mentioned, if he just did it on the Ursa, you've got Shallow Grave that might come out. There's also the Swap. There's the Ravage. You could get Astral Imprisoned. So suddenly, the Ursa gets Astral Imprisoned, so nobody's doing damage to him. Patience by Bulba.
It is like you said, they don't want to take engagements that they don't have to take. Granted, you can trade one for one with the Bounty Hunter track. Great. But they definitely don't want to give this OD a chance to get out of control. And OD does not farm anywhere near as fast as this Fen does. Right? So eventually that OD will just kind of start to fall behind him. We're actually seeing him fall pretty substantially behind at this point.
Yeah, this Fen, you are taking stacks. His team's calls to invade their jungle and take their stacks. They've been doing a really good job. And speaking of good jobs, Mario, oh no, caught in the Chronosphere, blown up by that Sunstrike and now Slix. He's going to take quite a bit of damage. I don't think he'll fall here. He's actually, oh, as I spoke too soon, you are blinked in, helps out with some of that damage. Shallowgrig does come out, snaking, trying to rip through their backlines, not even able to get 1437. The four stops coming out, saving his life, and now snaking, looking for something, but you are full mana. Could just Stormhammer him up and MJW. Your Rav just scares no one when there's no follow-up damage.
They will kind of back out of the fight. That ends up working out really well for DC.
Snaking is dead.
Now it really works out for DC. I have no idea what Snaking was doing going down there.
Just underestimated the power of Resolution's Invoker. He's had the Midas for quite some time. He's almost level 16. He is full Exort. And again, to take a look at the net worth graph, they are 10,000 net worth ahead on DC, over 10,000 experience. This just seems to be the games for them now.
Yeah, and that's only about 2,000, maybe 2,500 out of Tower Gold as well. So that is really, they're pretty even on kills. That advantage comes partially from track and a lot from superior farming.
I mean, DC, this new DC is looking very, very good. I'm incredibly impressed. There's going to be a blink forward, the Stormhammer out onto MGW. Sunstrike going to be off the mark. And now Yawar, he does still have that Aegis. So even if he falls here, he can respawn and pop that God String. Meatball is dropped, going to kind of zone the folks. Aoi throwing out shurikens and tracks. Let's see if they can do anything about the respawn Yawar. He's taking a lot of damage. They ravaged just for him. They're not going to hit anybody else, though. And though they get Yawar, it does mean that this next engagement, Resolution could blow them up or just leave. There's going to be a swap onto 1437, so he will not live to see another day. But Ravage on cooldown.
Anytime, when you're falling behind and kills are worth as much as they are now because of that AoE comeback goal, anytime you can get a kill, especially on a core. It's well worth the one-man Ravage.
We haven't talked too much about pickups, but Aoi has a 4-star. As we saw, 1437 has the Ghost Scepter. Invoker has Yule's bots, Blink, working on that Ags. Yawar, Blink, and that Sanjin Yasha. And finally, Bulba, you know, he has a Blink already. He was having trouble in that offlane, and now he's full Vlads and Blink.
5 Blink Daggers, a Yule Scepter, a 4-staff, not to mention innate hero abilities to manipulate ground between opponents. This is a very maneuverable game.
Yeah, and it makes a lot of sense with the spells that we've got lined up. If Ursa or Sven cannot hit you, right, they're both kiteable melee cores. Unfortunately, the bulk of this repositioning is coming out from DC.
Well, they do have 3 of the Blink Daggers, right? And Snaking is typically trying to use his Blink Dagger to initiate in, which means he's not using it to reposition once he's in a fight.
There's going to be coconuts thrown out onto Snaking, a shuriken to follow, but he wasn't hit by the Maledict. But the rest of DC is posturing, obviously, other than Resolution, who can boss in at any time. It doesn't matter, Yawar has decided to go on Slix, manages to get the Astral Imprisonment out. Svenge is ready with a swap, but Slix, he's going to take the Sunstrike, Chronosphere as well. Is there any stopping DC at this point? There's going to be a jump forward, your Resolution going for it. Instead, it's way too on the back line. He's going to be taking a lot of damage. MJW is just trying to reduce their damage when he can, and Snaking being kited around. Here comes the Meeple. He gets Shallow Grave, but it is just too much damage coming out. The Deafening Blow is going to push him off the mark, and this may just be GG. Way too, the only one, or sorry, MJW, the only one to survive, and for how long as he goes down to the Cold Snap?
I can't even get an anchor smash off. Poor guy. Short respawns, and they'll have a high ground defense on this next one, defending high ground a bit easier, although we did just see the entire DC squad dive through the middle tier 3 into the bottom tier 3, so I don't know how much of an argument that, well, there's a high ground coming. is really going to help POF.
That was almost a 5.5k gold swing for a team that was already over 10,000 net worth ahead. This is the power of Track and the Bounty Hunter. He wasn't off to a good start, but again, we've seen the superior teamwork of DC. Even when a couple of their teammates have bad starts, they make up for it.
Yeah, and once again, it comes out to really just making sure that they're rotating very frequently, that they are getting the maneuverability items that they need.
Okay, we're gonna have a swap onto 1437. He's taking quite a bit of damage. Ghost Scepter gonna save the day. Cooldown all frozen, and this is the Sunstrike and the Meatball gonna be taking a lot of damage. He did get off the Enrage. They'll finally kill off 1437, but who else will they catch? Nuwar pops that God Strength. He's ready to go back in whenever. He has the Blink and the Stormhammer. He could just pick up Slicks in one hit. Instead, throws out the Stormhammer, lets the Forge Spirits poke away at Snake King. And they're just gonna wait it.
I think that's a good disengage. The OD did was sitting on top of Astral Imprisonment and Sanity's Eclipse, so if the Sven did go in, it would have been a very risky call for a really low value hero. The support of the team that is behind in economics is worth basically nothing. Ghost will be up in a buck 30 here as well.
Yeah, it's another... It's actually an average Roshan spawn time, but again, not the long ones that might be helping Power of Friendship, although I'm not sure if DC will even bother getting an Aegis, and I wanted to point out, Aoi has Guardian Greaves.
Yeah, he... come up with all that track gold. He's been kind of rolling in it lately. He's not been getting a lot of kills, but he has been getting a lot of tracks out.
So on the upside, some items are starting to come out of Power of Friendship as well. We will be seeing... Oh, he already has the Axe. My mistake. I thought maybe he was building up the Octarine, but he already has the Axe. Snaking now going to be in a lot of trouble. Where's the Death Ward? They could just use it to blow him up. Sunstrike off the mark, but Bulba catches him in that ult. There's the swap. Mario is going to be taking it, and Snaking, even with the BKB and the heal up, he has to run away. There's nothing he can do. He can't stand and fight, and he may still die. Nuwar is on the chase, has a blink up in 1 second, gets it knocked on cooldown, and instead just going to use that God Strength on those towers. There is a casual gust, but with no Ravage, I don't see anything Power of Friendship can do. Way 2 gets Astral in prison to save his life, but this thing Snake King tanking that Death Ward and Sunstrike, gonna just finish him off. The Rax is going down quickly.
Boy, Slicks ended up popping his BKB and still taking the brute of that Death Ward, so he completely wasted his 10 second BKB charge as well. As though that fight hadn't been going poorly enough, and now Roshan happens to spawn right after that devastating push. That Power of Friendship really can't go out into the Rosh pit right now.
And the catapult, they know about it. DC indicates, you know, 1437 says, hey guys, we're getting this before we do another push. Let's not let any ounce of this game get away from us. And I don't think there's any chance to stop them. Bulba has an axe.
Is a Blink Ravage up in 7 seconds.
So what's your damage?
Snake King maybe blows one guy up, right? And after that, you're hoping for OD to be able to save the day with that Sandy's Eclipse.
Oh, we'll see. Aoi hasn't tracked anyone up, but of course they have clear vision from all of these wards. Our Friendship are actually the ones posturing in the Roshan pit. The Chronosphere is up in 7 seconds, and so I'm pretty sure Bulba is about to show them all. We'll see. They're getting out of the pit on Power of Friendship, wanting to make sure only one person max gets caught up. Instead, Slicks being bashed away by Yawa. He has to pop his BKB. Mario now in a horrible spot. One more auto attack will kill him off. He pops his wand, but he is going down, and they are not able to do too much. They have lost Snake King in the Roach Pit too, and they call it.
Yeah, without that Aegis Cheese, there's absolutely nothing they can do.
And again, Yawa. Okay. Deny the Aegis. Get that stat in there. with that, another quick one coming out. This one, not as quick, but DC were dominant for about after the 10-minute mark onwards.
I'm pretty sure, I haven't checked this in the last week or two, but I'm pretty sure DC's average game time is like 33, 35 minutes, something like that. They've been just blissful.